Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Philosophy and the Law, How Judges Reason. Your professor is Stephen Mathis, an associate professor and chairman of the philosophy department at Wheaton College. He teaches a variety of courses in legal philosophy, as well as in social political philosophy. Professor Mathis is also the coordinator of the Legal Studies Minor and Pre-Law Advisor. His primary research interest is the philosophy of criminal law, but he has also written on topics in political philosophy, moral theory, and ethics. In his spare time, Professor Mathis follows politics and the Supreme Court very closely, and has authored op-ed pieces on constitutional law issues. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Philosophy and the Law, How Judges Reason. Lecture 1, Legal Realism. And now, Professor Mathis.
In this course, we're going to look at the study of jurisprudence. The course is called How Judges Reason. From a philosophical perspective, it might be better to call it How Judges Ought to Reason. In philosophy, this is actually a fairly new discipline, a fairly new subfield, I should say. And lawyers have been studying law, judges have been studying law, legal scholars have been studying law for hundreds of years. In the Anglo-American tradition, which is the tradition in which we'll be working in this course, the tradition that comes from England and has come over to the United States and changed in certain ways, and in other ways has stayed very much the same. From England, it's the common law tradition that we're carrying over. The common law just really means having judges decide cases as they come before them, and those cases becoming precedent and then becoming the kinds of things that other judges will look at going forward. And that sounds perfectly familiar to us, I think, in the United States. But common law actually means usually that there are no statutes behind these decisions, that the decisions just come along and over a long period of time, and judges do their work by following what previous judges have done. And over time, all kinds of cases, all kinds of principles come out of the law, and judges try to find those and follow those. And so that's the common law tradition that we get from England. England, though, is not a constitutional legal system like ours is in the United States. In fact, England doesn't have a constitution, and so that itself marks a rather major difference between the English system and the American system. But both of these systems draw on the common law tradition to start with, and so even where there are statutes where in modern times Congress or the Parliament passes statutes, we'll follow those in much the same way as the British do, and then we incorporate at our constitutional level, which again the British don't have, we incorporate both the study of statutes and the study of common law, and look at precedent cases as well as studying the text of a statute, in this case a super statute, you might call it the Constitution. So we're working in that tradition. That tradition has been is 800 years old at least, dating back to England. And so it's a very rich tradition, but as philosophers go, philosophers didn't start approaching the law as a philosophical question really seriously until the 20th century. I should qualify that a bit, that we have Aristotle, who worked on issues of law. We have Thomas Aquinas and Augustine, who worked on issues of law that date quite a ways back, but they did it very quickly. They did it in very general terms. They didn't work on actual law as it's practiced, but talked much more in idealistic terms of how the law ought to be. So that is part of the tradition that we work with, and it follows up through into the 17th and 18th century, where we start to see authors like Jeremy Bentham, and then his student John Austin, whom we'll talk about in this course, really working out some of the philosophical questions having to do with the law in a much more concrete and a much more developed way than we saw with some of the ancients and some of the medieval philosophers. So fast forward a bit further, and you get to, really interestingly enough, 1961, H.L.A. Hart comes onto the scene and writes The Concept of Law, and that book really marks the beginning of philosophy of law as a subdiscipline of philosophy. Again, we've had legal theory for hundreds of years leading up to that, but doing philosophy, really asking the tough philosophical questions about what law is, what the concepts mean, breaking them down in a way that philosophers do, that legal theorists don't always do, that part is relatively new. In this case, it's about 60, 50 years old. And so as a result, the readings for this course, the authors that I'm going to draw on in this course are, you might say, somewhat limited. We'll start with looking at the legal realists. And the realists, the two examples that we're going to talk about are Oliver Wendell Holmes, who was a famous American jurist, a judge, wrote some famous pieces on law, but he wasn't a philosopher. He falls into the category, as I say, of legal realism, which is a not quite philosophical view, but it's really the best precursor to the real philosophical views that we want to talk about. So we'll start with Holmes and another realist named Jerome Frank. And then after that, we'll move to talking about John Austin, who was a student of Jeremy Bentham, and who really started to lay out some of the views that started the discipline eventually, when Hart picks them up and runs with them in a slightly different way. We'll talk about Austin and then go straight to Hart and talk about H.L.A. Hart's work. He is the most important philosopher of law out there, mainly because he started the discipline. So we'll talk about Hart for really parts of two lectures. And then I've chosen a book by one of Hart's students called Law's Empire, and the author is Ronald Dworkin. And Ronald Dworkin is probably the most important philosopher of law living today. Law's Empire might be the most influential book on philosophy of law besides Hart's Concept of Law, written in the 20th century. And so even though there are critics of Dworkin and some criticisms will raise, the nice thing about Dworkin's view is it's one of the first ones to really take the point of view of the judge in trying to do philosophy of law and trying to figure out how judges really do or ought to do what they do. The study in a broad sense, I've already used the term jurisprudence, so I should probably stop for a second and tell you. The term jurisprudence really just means the science of doing the law. And so when you take a course, say, in law school on jurisprudence, it will be, in a lot of ways, it'll look an awful lot like a philosophy of law or theory of law kind of course. And so it'll look at things in very general terms, look at actions, what kind of actions the law looks for, what counts as an act, for example, would be part of jurisprudence, what counts as a harm, what intent means, very general terms like that. So jurisprudence is quite broad. Actually, it's broader than just how judges reason. Jurisprudence applies to really everything that lawyers and judges do. What we're really going to focus on in this course, for the majority of the course anyway, is theories of adjudication. It'll take us a while to work ourselves from broader jurisprudential theories to a view like Dworkin's view, which will be a big part of this course, which is itself an adjudicative theory. It's a theory of adjudications, theory of how judges do what they do, how they decide cases. And so adjudicative theory is really what we're looking for. And we'll spend a good bit of time on Dworkin. And the reason we spend time on Dworkin is because, two reasons. One is Dworkin's extremely important in the philosophy of law, and we couldn't do a course in adjudication or in jurisprudence without mentioning him. But the other reason is because I thought in designing this course and identifying some primary readings that Dworkin's book touches on all the important theories that compete with his. He doesn't always deal with them fairly, doesn't always deal with them in the most most thoroughly charitable way, but you could you can buy one book in this case and have really a very comprehensive view of what theories of adjudication will look like, and it's arguably the most sophisticated of it. You know, at the time that it came out, it was the most sophisticated theory of adjudication that came out, and I think it really gets things started in a nice way. So that's why we're going to spend as many as 6 lectures, I think, on Dworkin's book, Law's Empire. And then at the end, we'll spend a few more lectures on a theory by Bruce Ackerman, who is actually also not a philosopher, but is a constitutional law professor at Yale. And Bruce Ackerman writes a book called We the People. Actually, it's part of a trilogy. The one I'll be referring to is We the People Foundations, which is Volume 1. We the People Foundations is really a kind of interdisciplinary constitutional history of sorts. And so the reason I add that at the end is that as we follow through Dworkin's theory, we'll get through to the very end, and the ultimate goal at the end of that is to talk about be able to talk about constitutional law. We'll build toward constitutional law. And constitutional law is arguably the most interesting part of theories of jurisprudence and adjudication anyway. So we'll look at Dworkin's views on constitutional law and on law in general, and then turn and look at an alternative approach. I think it's quite different in a lot of ways. Very complementary approach, though, to Dworkin's view in Ackerman's We the People. So, and then at the end, hopefully we can do some comparison and talk about some really important constitutional issues and try to get at what exactly is going on in the kinds of decisions that judges make in landmark kinds of cases, the most important kinds of cases. So that's really the layout of the course. That's really the two main terms that I want you to be familiar with at the beginning, with jurisprudence and adjudication. But hopefully that gives you a feel for where we're headed in this course and why we might spend so much time on a current author like Dworkin. But now I should shift and talk about legal realism. Legal realism is the place that we should begin today, begin in this lecture, because, as I said, it sets up the moves to more philosophical approaches that come later. Also, for realism, realism is one of the earliest attempts in American jurisprudence to do real philosophy about how judges reason on things. Oliver Wendell Holmes is maybe the most famous legal realist. I should note, by the way, here that by Oliver Wendell Holmes, I don't mean the famous poet, but in fact his son, Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., who was a judge in Massachusetts and then eventually associate justice on the Supreme Court. Holmes is maybe the most famous legal realist. He's been tagged as a legal realist. I don't know that he would have called himself such a thing. But nevertheless, Holmes has the view in a very famous piece he wrote in the Harvard Law Review in 1897 called The Path of the Law. And in The Path of the Law, he argues that really law is about, if you want to study the law, if you want to find out what the law is, really what you will discover is that the study of law is really nothing more than a prediction. It's a prediction of what judges are going to do in given cases or how a court is going to rule in a given case. When you study the law, what you do is you try to predict in a novel case what it is that a judge or a court is going to say. The means of studying the, you know, and arriving at these predictions is to look at all of the reports, treatises, statutes, prior decisions, precedents. All of that is what we'll study in the law. Now, the interesting part of this is that even though Oliver Wendell Holmes himself was a judge, in fact, one of our most famous and most important judges, he writes this piece in The Path of the Law talking about what the law is from the point of view, oddly enough, of a lawyer. The point of view that he takes is the point of view of a lawyer advising a client. And from the point of view of a lawyer advising a client, discussions about rights, discussions about legal duties, discussions about even what's right and wrong, he thinks are completely irrelevant. And that if you want to know what the law is, then you want to know essentially what is a court, what is a judge going to do in a given case. And so this is an early attempt at trying to distinguish or define, you might say, what law is. And for Holmes, he recognizes very early on that morality is a key part of the law, that the law expresses the public's morality in very important and clear ways. And that's not something we want to ignore, but it's something that we don't want to give too much credence to, because if we do, we're more likely to lose track of what we really mean by the law, as opposed to morality or as opposed to claims about right and wrong in a much broader sense. And so what Holmes wants to do is to distinguish law from morality. He wants to distinguish law from other kinds of endeavors. And if you ask, he thinks, you know, you want to ask what the law is, then it's going to be a fairly narrow description, and you're going to want to get out all of the things that are distracting or leave out all of the things that are distracting or not clearly focused on just what the law is. And so he suggests that if you want to know or appreciate what the law is in and of itself, and again, this is, he takes the point of view of the lawyer, he thinks you want to know, you want to take the point of view of the bad man. And by the bad man, you could imagine a bad client. And the reason he wants you to take the point of view of a bad man as opposed to a good man is that as a client, the good man might do good things, might avoid doing bad things in particular, might avoid doing the bad things that break the law because he's a good man and he internalizes the moral rules that you might say underlie the law. And so when he does that, when he internalizes the moral rules underneath the law, then he conflates in some ways, Holmes might say, the moral and the legal. And it would be hard as a lawyer to see which one he's more interested in. If you want to know what the law is all about, you should talk to the bad man, because the bad man's not going to be interested at all in the moral question. He will not be held back at all by moral considerations that, or even guilt or conscience. What he'll be held back by, or what he'll be worried about the most, is what is the law going to do to me if I do this? And that, Holmes thinks, gets right to the key of what it is that the law says, and what the law means and what the law is. The point of view of the bad man is going to be very telling for that reason. So to drive this maybe even a little further yet, what we might say is that abstract talk of rights or duties, as I mentioned before, rights and duties from the point of view of the bad man really don't make a whole lot of difference. Do I have a right to this? Do I have a duty to perform this way under the law? Those are very abstract, principled terms that really, in some ways, harken back to moral kinds of terminology. Bad man really doesn't care whether he has rights. He doesn't care whether he has duties. He cares whether or not the law is going to smack him if he does the bad thing, if he does the thing that it doesn't want him to do. He doesn't care about rights. He only cares if there's a way in which the law will have to let him off. So to Holmes, the law isn't about all of these kind of abstract things. It isn't about rights or duties or things like that. The law is about, more about principles, you might say. The law is about a prediction of what's going to happen if you do action X. Now, part of the reason that Holmes takes this approach is Holmes takes this approach because he's responding, as I think the realist in general did, to a view that goes back to England prior to this period of time called legal formalism. And legal formalism was a popular view, I think in some ways still is a popular view, and what it holds is that judges can and do logically deduce their decisions from legal principles or abstract notions like rights and things like that, along with the facts of the case. Well, Holmes thought that is a really big mistake, that if confusing law with logic is almost like confusing law with morality, you don't get at the heart of the thing by talking in those terms. You don't get at the heart of law by talking in those terms. Just like morality, talk of morality can blur certain distinctions for you in the law. Let me give you another example of that, actually, to go back, one that I meant to give before. Something like malice or, bad intent. He thinks, where we have statutes that say, or where we have tort law that says you can't, that you will have to pay damages if you do this or that with malice or with an evil intention. He thinks, malice, evil intent, mens rea is another term that we use in this context, guilty mind. None of those things, all of those things have moral connotations to them. But fundamentally, they aren't really questions about the real moral questions like what was the defendant's motive or what was the defendant's state of mind like what was he really thinking? What did he really mean? They don't care about that. They just really the question of law is, and nothing more, is just did the person cause the harm in the way that will make him liable to pay for it? That's really all malice means, is it's a set of conditions that one has to meet. And so worrying about really his moral state of mind misses the point to a large degree. And when really what's at stake is, have the conditions been met for one to be held liable for damages or not? But back to this issue about logic. Holmes thought that logic in the law, there certainly is, just like with morality, there's logic within the law. Lawyers are trained in logic. A lot of the way that they argue is analogical, using analogies and things. And so there's plenty of logic in the law, but to think that logic could be reduced, I mean, that law could be reduced to logic, is to make a fundamental mistake. He thinks that in the end, logic can be, well, I should say any conclusion, he thinks, could be made into, put into logical form, could be made to look like a logical conclusion, and that in the end, there are, logic can serve the purpose of masking or dressing up different points of view that we just happen to have on things, different really fundamentally political points of view that we have on things. And so if you look at logic alone, you miss the fact that there are fundamental, maybe political kinds of theoretical kinds of disagreements about what the proper values are in the law, what things we ought to be going for, what kinds of things we ought not to be going for in the law. And that if you focus just on the logic, then you miss that fact. You miss the fact that there's plenty of real debate about values, real debate about what's important in society within the law. And so he wants to reject formalism. He wants to say that logic is not the primary way of understanding the law. The problem is, with this perspective, is that it seems to suggest, then, instead, that what we need to be able to do is just merely predict what the judge is going to do, not provide any reasons for thinking that he's going to do it, or not provide many reasons beyond the fact that other reports and statutes and prior decisions seem to indicate this. Those would be reasons, but he thinks they're not necessary reasons. They're not reasons that are going to force us to a particular conclusion in the way that some premise in logic might force us to a conclusion. That judges will impose their own points of view, and that it's not really it's not a matter of logic. It's not a matter of strict principles that are going to guide us in a necessary kind of way. And so this has led some philosophers to ridicule realists as saying that basically judges' decisions, or the law, comes down to what the judge had for breakfast, meaning that the judge's particular idiosyncrasies, the way he feels that morning, something like that, could contribute fundamentally to what kind of decision he makes, according to the realists. And that seems like a very skeptical view of the law, a view that doesn't see the law as really having any real, deep, fundamental meaning to it. In fact, it's rather, as I said, skeptical about it. It thinks maybe it's just a sort of sham, if you will, that hides the judge's subjective preference. Jerome Frank, whom I mentioned before, is another famous realist. Jerome Frank also argued that law is nothing more than prediction, that to know what the law is, you either have to have something decided in advance, and so you know what the law is once a judge has made his decision, or you're engaged in some predictive endeavor trying to predict what it is a judge is going to decide. But until a judge decides, matter's not settled. We don't, he claims, know what the law really is until a judge decides on it. And so that pushes it maybe even a little further than Holmes does, to say that, it does seem to be just up to judges, and that there are no principles, there are no fundamental notions like rights and duties that give us a real clear idea of what the law should be, where it's not perfectly explicit or perfectly clear, and that it is in some way deeply wide open to the judge's whims. That seems problematic for us. I think that's not a way that judges actually see their work, and that's a problem. But beyond that, even if it were a way that judges see their work, the problem with realism from a philosophical point of view is that realism is really a sociological theory or a descriptive theory. It's really about studying the law as it is and describing it accurately, even though, as I've already indicated, I'm not sure it's an accurate description in the first place. But it's a purely descriptive theory, and philosophers are much more interested in what we might call normative or prescriptive theories. And by normative, we mean appealing to some kind of norm, having some, and by prescriptive, we mean giving us an ought, telling us something about how cases ought to be decided. So normative, prescriptive, these are the way that the kinds of terms, the kinds of theories that philosophers are particularly interested in. Descriptive theories are going to be more characteristic of social science, maybe history, something like that, where you're trying to just characterize it accurately, not try to talk about how it ought to be or how it ought to be done. And when we're looking at possible theories for adjudication, what we're really looking for is we're looking for some way of saying this is how judges ought to decide cases, not just this is how they do decide cases, because look at the realist in particular. If we just say this is how judges do decide it, boy, that's an awful place to be left. And to just say this is how it is, that it's up to what the judge had for breakfast, in a sense, that leaves us in really a bad place, and there's no way of saying that that's right or that's wrong. That's just the way it is. And there's a difference between describing something in, say, a scientific kind of way and then or evaluating it in this case, in a philosophical way and asking, is it right? Is it wrong? Could it be better? Could it be worse? And in the case of the realists, it would be helpful for us to be able to say, when a judge goes and decides a case in this way, it's acceptable. If he decides the case in this other way, it's too far out there, and it doesn't really fit with the way we understand the law, or it's a radical kind of decision. But the realists give us no way of saying that, one way or another. And this is a deep problem from a philosophical point of view. One last thing on realism, though, is that the realists, I should note, see the law as indeterminate. They see the law as inconclusive. There are gaps in it, that it will not dictate to you a given answer one way or another in every case, and that there will be times where judges just use their discretion and there you go. And that's not necessarily a problem to think that the law is indeterminate. In fact, we'll look at several arguments that hold that same view, that the law doesn't cover every case, because if it did, then what judges do would be a whole lot easier than it is. But the problem with the indeterminacy is that when the law is indeterminate, we would like a prescriptive theory that tells us how a judge ought to go and fill that gap or address that less clear part of the law. And the realists give us nothing to that effect. And while realism gives us some interesting things to say about the law and the actual practice of the law and the way judges decide cases, we as philosophers of law need more than that. We need a view that's going to give guidance to judges, tell judges on the front end how they ought to go about deciding cases, and give us tools for evaluating the various interpretations and decisions that judges make. In the next lecture, we'll move on to talk about a view that called legal positivism that comes from a philosopher named John Austin and then is picked up and developed in more detail by H.L.A. Hart, whom I mentioned earlier. And in those two views, we're going to see a real step into real philosophical prescriptive kinds of theories and a move away from these more simplistic descriptive theories.
This ends Lecture 1. Philosophy and the Law, Lecture 2. Legal Positivism, Part 1.
This is the first of two lectures that we're going to do on legal positivism, which is really the first major philosophical theory dealing with jurisprudence, dealing with adjudication. And this comes from H.L.A. Hart, whom I mentioned in the previous lecture. Hart comes along in the 60s and makes in 1960s and really puts this theory on the map. But there are some predecessors to Hart that we can talk about that are important to talk about. Legal positivism, we can trace it all the way back to the famous utilitarian philosopher Jeremy Bentham, who was in the mid-1700s, lived in the mid-1700s to the early 1800s. Bentham wrote extensively about political philosophy and about philosophy of law, in fact. But it's his star pupil, John Austin, in the early to mid-1800s, who refined and codified many of his views on jurisprudence. And so Austin's work helped really launch the legal positivist movement that we're going to talk about in this lecture and the next. The focus of Austin's work is something that we now call analytical jurisprudence, and that is that a focus on analyzing and trying to define the concept of law. That's to be distinguished from normative jurisprudence, which we'll also talk about in this course, but which normative jurisprudence is just talking about the law as it should be. And normative jurisprudence, you might say, is the idea that is an approach to law that political philosophers, but also, you might say, legislators and politicians would focus on, talking about how the law ought to be. Whereas analytical jurisprudence, this view that comes from John Austin, is really all about trying to define, analyze, understand the concept of law itself, or, you know, you might say, what does law, in quotes, mean? The definitions that Austin and others after him put forward are rooted in social practice. They're rooted in the actual practice of how we do things. In that sense, it's the next logical step from the realists that we talked about before. The realists were very sociological, very descriptive theories. This is the next logical step where we're also going to study what law is, what law means, but we're going to look at it in a more analytical, more theoretical kind of way. It's going to be rooted in actual practice again. So it's the next step before we move on to get away from, you know, it's the next step between is how law is and how law maybe ought to be. And to be perfectly frank with you, we're not probably ever going to talk completely about how the law ought to be, because that's not really what judges are going to end up doing or looking at, and nor is it what we want them to do or look at. But we'll talk more about that later. The word positivism comes from the idea that these philosophers are worried about law as it's posited. That means, you know, you might say, or as it's created, as it's practiced, as it's put out there in the world. And they're not worried about justifying law in moral terms. They're not worried about trying to say, is the law justified? Is the law just top to bottom? That's something they're not worried about. This goes back to the distinction I made in the first lecture between morality and law, and trying to keep those things distinct and look at, in this case, as philosophers, just at law itself. So, and there's some really good reason for doing that in the end, right off the bat, and that is that if you try to say from the beginning that laws have to be morally justified and things like this, then you notice pretty quickly that there are all kinds of laws that really don't have that much moral content one way or another. You find that you know, laws about, let's say, traffic laws, for example, that we drive on one side of the street as opposed to the other, those are laws. There's not really much moral content in it. Whether we drive on the right side of the road or the left side of the road, as the British do, is there one right? Is there one wrong? That's really difficult to say. But they are laws, and we do want to talk about them. We might want to talk about those as laws. And if we want to understand what law is in and of itself, we'll want to pick those kinds of law, those kinds of rules up in our definition, in our concept of it. So, and this is the kind of thing that the positivists had in mind, that they were saying that you could define law, that when you went to define law in a very analytical kind of way, you had to pick up all of these things, and that the moral component isn't necessarily always there. So it's the notion of trying to get a definition together. If you want to get a definition together of anything, you're going to identify its essential characteristics, that thing's essential characteristics one way or another. And by identifying its essential characteristics, you rule out all sorts of other things that that thing is not. Good example that I often use with my students is the definition of a chair. If you think through what is a chair and you start working through that for a while, you'll realize, well, it's going to be something that has a seat. But there are lots of things that have seats. There are things like stools and sofas and merry-go-rounds. And so we need to define it a little more carefully, because none of those other things are actually chairs. And so then you realize, well, chairs tend to have backs to them. Chairs tend to seat one person, for example. They often have legs. I suppose they sometimes can have wheels and things as well. So you can see what I mean then, I think, that the definition is going to be actually kind of narrow, and it's going to rule out lots of things. And it doesn't tell us necessarily everything we would ever want to know about, say, a chair, but that it has a seat, it has a back, and it's for one person. Something like that, that kind of definition is the kind of definition we're looking for law, or at least that's the kind of definition that the positivists will set out to look for law. In 1831, Austin lays out his arguments for the essential features of law, and he tries to distinguish law from other things that you might confuse with it, like morality, for example. And his definition of law, and this is a direct quote, is he defines law as, quote, commands backed by threat of sanctions from a sovereign to whom people have a habit of obedience. That's the end of the quote. So what do we mean by sovereign, I suppose, might be the first thing we want to look at. Austin had in mind by sovereign a ruler, a powerful person, someone in a position of authority. Not necessarily one person. It could be a parliament. It could be a local municipality or something like that. So, again, commands backed by threat of sanctions from a sovereign to whom people have a habit of obedience. The key insight here that we want to focus on, the thing that Austin does so nicely, is he notices that law has a peculiar kind of force. Law impinges on us differently than other sorts of rules do. In particular, other sorts of rules don't always carry with them a threat of punishment. And so that's going to be, you know, one key distinction. They are also commands. They're going to be in the form of, you might say, an imperative. Do this, don't do that. They're not usually worded as, you might say, hypothetical suggestions, like, if you want to do this, then you ought to do that. They're not like that. They're going to be commands. They're going to be imperatives. They're going to be backed by threats of pain and suffering, perhaps, whether it's monetary or loss of liberty or something like that. And then it's something to whom people have the habit of obedience. So, again, this is going to distinguish law from other sorts of rules. in particular, moral rules in this case. Moral rules, if we could agree on them, I think there are some we probably could in general terms, like you shouldn't kill innocent people. We all agree that perhaps you shouldn't kill innocent people, but as a moral claim, that's a very different kind of claim than saying there is a law in place that says you will not kill innocent people lest you be put in prison for the rest of your life or even executed. The difference between the two is to say, with the moral case, it's not necessarily backed up by anything. I say not necessarily because it might be that God backs them up or in the next life or something like that. But in terms of moral judgments in general, on this planet anyway, they're not backed by force. And so that's going to exclude moral judgments, moral laws from what we want to call the law, or moral rules from the law. The law also obliges us is a key part here. It obliges us to act. It tells us that, it forces us, pushes us from behind, you might say, with this threat to act in one way or another. It doesn't give us a reward. It doesn't entice us. It doesn't say, oh, come along, please, and if you do, you'll get this nice treat. It says, if you don't do this, you're going to get smacked, essentially. These are key insights for Austin. Another one here to say it's a command, and as in his view, he plays this out, that it's not just a command. It's a command of a certain sort. It's going to have to be a command that applies to actions in a general sense, not actions in a really specific sense, an isolated act, you might say. So an example I use oftentimes is to say, if the sovereign, the king or legislature or whoever, commands that a particular guy has to wear a particular hat on a particular day of the year, in a given year, let's say, that's going to be a little too specific to be considered a law, to be considered the type of command that we have in mind. They need to be sufficiently general. They need to be apply to general types of actions, need to apply to general types of actions that all sorts of people might engage in, not just certain ones for certain people. So again, it wouldn't be just a law that applies to one person doing one action at a given time. And the final piece that I mentioned before is that people are going to habitually follow these rules if they're going to be laws, that people habitually follow them. Now, what's interesting about that is that habitually following, you say, well, why do they habitually follow them other than the fact that they have a threat of punishment? Isn't that kind of redundant somehow? And I think that what Austin has in mind here is that law really needs to be some kind of accepted social norm, and that, of course, there needs to be a threat to make sure that people don't, you might say, cheat the system and go do whatever they want to do. But in general, they're going to be socially accepted. They're going to be the kind of thing that people are in the habit of following on a regular basis. And so that's Austin's definition of law. It's commands backed by a threat of sanctions from a sovereign to people who have a habit of obedience. And so that's, our first, you might say, philosophical, analytic definition of law. Hart comes along later, much later, over 130 years later, shows up, H.L.A. Hart, British scholar, studied at Oxford, taught at Oxford. Hart criticizes Austin's view. He comes along, and Hart is really credited with starting the discipline of philosophy of law. And he does it by criticizing Austin's view and then offering his own positivistic approach to defining law. He thinks Austin's view is a little too simplistic. He thinks that commands backed by a sovereign to people who are in the habit of obeying, doesn't cover a lot of the things in law that we want, that we would typically call law. And so as a definition, it's perhaps too narrow. In particular, the primary counterexample, you might say, that we have here is that Hart would offer is to say, just look at civil law, just look at contract law, just look at tort law. These aspects of the law that has to do with whether or not we want to enforce given contracts, whether or not we want to force people to pay damages for certain kinds of activities. And that's not criminal activities, but pay damages for doing things that they ought not be doing, say, in business, for example.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.